Hey, this is Timothy Francis McTague from Underoath, and this is the first ever video journal entry for the recording of our new compact disc out on Solid State Records. We're gonna go check out Glow in the Dark. Here's where we're gonna be recording our drums and keyboards.
It's time to freaking make a record.
Oh God! Everything!
Couple amps. Couple keyboards. Hardwood floors. Go check out the old control room. Monitors. Computer. Little glass so you can see what's going on. Microphone. If this record were to come out and go quadruple platinum, and you were in a position where you could have anything on the rider that you would like, what would it be?
Well, I thought long and hard about this question. I've come up with a pretty extensive rider that I'm going to type out and give to Suzanne in the near future.
Consisting of?
Well, my room, my own private dressing room, would be no less than 1,000 square feet with its own private bathroom, and in the bathroom will be located a jacuzzi tub kept at 106 degrees at all times for me to use however I would like.
Hey! There's the man of the hour. One night we were just sitting there, we were trying to wrap our heads around who we would feel comfortable producing a record. And Matt Goldman from Atlanta, a guy who we've recorded with plenty of times doing pre-production and just a lot of different things, helped us write some of the programming for the last record. We just felt really comfortable with him.
How do you feel right now?
I mean, I feel pretty full.
Gino, I'm here.
That's what I like to hear.
He's pretty much like a feel-good vibe. Like when we work with him, things are just awesome and totally fun. And it's not like you're stressed out or working on something, you know, and freaking out about it. You're just like, it's all good times.
Matt can get really great drum sounds.
I'm a fan of not having the snare sound exactly the same through the whole record.
No, we'll change the next song.
Yeah. He's pretty much just a dude, man. He has his own facial hair, like his own name brand facial hair, the Goldman. Right there alone just pretty much says it all.
Day one!
Adam D is in the house.
House? Me? Here?
The idea of Adam came up, and we just got off tour with Killswitch on the Taste of Chaos tour that year, and there's just a lot of different things going on where we're just like, man, that dude's legit.
I got some squeals and some dive bombs just for you guys. I'll reserve. It's gonna be sweet.
Man, if we could have just Matt Goldman and Adam collaborate on the record, it would just be awesome. It would sound good, it would have a good vibe, it would just artistically, we felt like it would be there. And I got on the phone with Adam and just pretty much asked him and asked Matt that next day, and within a week or two everything kind of worked out.
We were supposed to start drums today, but we decided to change course and demo out the entire record in one day live, just so everyone can kind of show everyone their parts and get on the same page. So that's what we're getting ready to do right now.
I think that writing for this record was different because when we were writing for the last record, we didn't have a whole lot of time. And this time we had a lot more time to write, and it was pretty awesome.
This is where most of the Underoath stuff is written. This little speaker right there and right there. They make sound. There's a laptop and just a couple things. It's a hard drive and a keyboard.
and yeah, pretty much just demo things out and come up with ideas, put them down, show the dudes, and vice versa. If it wasn't for modern technology, we wouldn't have been able to write this record because pretty much been on the road all year, setting up two kits, silver IOT kit for the actual record, and that kit right there for demoing and just riffing out ideas so we don't beat up the heads on the big kit.
Any special people at home?
What? What?
I think the people at home would like to know.
Would like to know what?
If you have a girlfriend, duh.
Do I have a girlfriend? At this point, I don't.
Situation where you know, we're in this poppy produced fake substanceless music scene where every band sounds the same, and we're trying to do something and keep the same mindset that we had when we were recording They're Only Chasing Safety, and that's to just keep pushing the limits, to put something in kids' hands that is unexpected, that's going to make them look outside, you know, their genre specific pop screamo CD collection. And so that's why we're doing things the way we are now. And when we were picking producers, we felt like we really needed somebody who got that, who understood and saw the vision for that. We just spent the last week recording. It's just a really good vibe. Trying different things, we were tweaking kits and had, you know, different drums set up in different parts of the room to get different effects, and we were just really trying a lot of different things, and that's something that we felt like we really needed to make sure was available to us, that creative outlet. All the songs have come together really, really good.
Oh, word!
I think I ungrouped your drums.
Now, my dressing room will be themed. There will be multiple themes for different days. Whatever day I feel like having the theme be, it will be so said theme. One theme would be toy birthday party day. The room will be decked out in every Lego erector set, friggin' unbelievable Toys R Us, everything.
Erector set.
Dude, erector sets are bad as crap. And it'll be everything, and then right before I'm about to go to stage, like 1 hour, 10 people dressed up in full clown uniforms will come into the room with a birthday cake and sing me happy birthday to build my spirits before I play.
So we're here at Zing Studios in Westfield, Massachusetts. We're about to record some guitars for the old record, and yeah. Let's go check it out.
Yep, there it is. Ain't she a beaut? Four pretty sweet amps right there. Too hot to touch.
What's that? Oh, it's Chris's neck.
Oh! 2 days of growth.
Here, come into the light.
I gotta get in the light.
Oh, no. Hold on, I gotta focus. Oh, yeah.
2 days?
not 2 days, is it?
Yeah, I shaved 2 days ago.
Oh.
I can grow it fast, but then I can't grow
here,
it
here, check
thick.
Mine.
Ponder. Ponder all that. Mm.
How about the neck beard?
Right, you need more light. There you go. And look at that sucker.
Grant on this week's video update. Look at his Lego hair.
Tim's a little mad at me. I don't know if you can tell, my beard kind of took over his.
It's hair that came off of another Lego piece and clipped onto him. He can interchange it with medieval knights, space helmets. He can do anything. I think that's the title he's going for now. He's the Lego hair champion of Underoath.
Dude, let's see how much this dude showcases. Hold on. This young man bid $70,000 on a trip and a car. $29,000 difference of what is that? Freaking $40,000. Oh my god.
Oh no.
How does it feel also having Lego hair yourself?
Having Lego hair? Dude, having Lego hair is great. There's nothing wrong with it.
Okay.
I mean, let's be honest. No, I actually have a date with my
girlfriend. Right now, we're in the middle of getting guitar sounds, bass sounds, etc. in here.
We didn't expect their only chasing safety to do close to what it did, and with that, we found a lot more pressure, a lot more eyes watching, expecting something from us, a lot of different people trying to get their hands on what we're doing, because we're not just a band that creates music anymore. We're a business venture, we're a risk, we're a possible high profit gain, pretty much just a business to a lot of people now.
If you were a flavor of Jell-O pudding snacks, one that may not exist or does exist in the Jell-O pudding snack line, what flavor would best describe you? Would it be salmon?
Asparagus?
Lobster?
Definitely not cream of shrimp. Definitely not. Tapioca. I'm white. I've got lots of little. I'm warm and squishy on the inside. I'm globule like.
Dude, one out of four ain't bad.
What was that garbage?
It wasn't garbage, no. But it kind of had an essence of garbage. Kind of like after you take out the trash. Odor lingers.
What's your favorite part during the week, especially Wednesday nights?
Oh gosh! Oh, that was the stupidest question.
What's that?
I like to watch Lost with my friend Grant.
What a setup!
As you see, it's about a quarter after seven. Tim's in there tracking guitar. We're killing time in various ways. We're gonna go see what Grant's doing. It is a road case. with a built-in TV just for Halo. Wireless router.
Sport that headset. There you go.
Check one, so. Check one, so. Yes, it's still warm. He's been here.
He was once here.
We'll continue tracking the beast. In track.
Not a big deal, it's just kind of what I do on an everyday basis.
The light from the sun.
So, what happened, Steve?
Me and Adam are outside talking, and pooped himself.
Oh. Dude, is it bad in there?
It looks like a stab wound.
So Adam just crapped his pants in between guitar tracks and vocal tracks.
Adam, you made some poopies in your pants.
Disaster averted.
What happened?
I just felt the warm brown just seep and line the crack of my cookies.
We all do it on the... What?
Of mixing with Chris Lord Alge. Are you the Lord of the Board?
You know I am.
We're just super psyched on the record. Man, yeah, it's just paid off. This is the last day of our mixing at Resonate Studios in Burbank, California. And we got a little going away present, a little Underoath cake. Chris!
Why gotta make fun of me, dude?
If you wanna know what we're about, that's what we're about.
Cakes.
Right there.
Cake.
How do you feel about this release now that you've heard it in its fruition, Lord Alge?
Awesome.
You know, every song that we have is just on point.
It's done in the studio.
Not quite
freaking
done.
Out, man, I gotta get out. I'm freaking out.
We've been in the studio for 6 days straight.
Is this like the prologue?
This is it.
Is this the exit hymn?
Every record we've ever recorded, we've always had that one song or those two or three songs that we wish were never there. And those were the mistakes and the black sheep and the sore thumb of the record. And this record, I feel, has 10, 11 songs that are all there for a reason, that all play a part in making this record a cohesive unit.
I feel really good about the songs. I feel a lot more confident, I think, in these songs than I do anything else that we've ever done. I don't know how people are going to take them. I think that they're definitely the smartest songs that we've ever written. I think that a lot more thought went into them, a lot more time went into them, and I just enjoy them as a whole more than anything we've ever done, and I hope people like them.
Today's your birthday?
Yeah. No way. Oh, we have to say happy birthday then.
It's not really. Aww. But it is my birthday the day the record comes out, so that's kind of cool.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Well, let's sing happy birthday to you now. Because it's all about the record.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Yeah. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear.
Define the great line.
Yeah. Happy birthday to you!
Go, Chris! We all gotta blow it out. Everybody blow it out.
Yay!
Uno, Chris.
Dos.
Uno, dos, tres.
Yeah!
Hi, my name is Chandler Owen, and we are here in Pahrump, Nevada. Welcome to day one of making the album packaging for Underoath.
So, we're leaving Pahrump, Nevada right now on our way to our first location in Death Valley. It's called the Devil's Golf Course. It's a pretty cool looking place. It's actually very alien looking because of these craggy, salt formations on the valley floor. So now we're pulling into Death Valley Park here. We just went from an altitude of 3,000 feet to what will be at roughly negative 280 feet here in the valley floor.
I think it's the kind of thing, this whole thing, you heli someone out of here by rope, dude.
We've done about 5 or 6 setups today. We just completed the Devil's Golf Course, and now we're in the sand dunes out here in Death Valley. And we're shooting our main character walking through this creek bed here in front of all these dead roots.
We're heading out to Ash Meadow. We're hoping it's not raining too much, but we'll see when we get out there.
This shot is a really unique shot for this album packaging. We're essentially faking time-lapse photography, and our character's going through 4 different stages here. He's going from normal to tired, and he's going to be this kind of withered guy, and all the time he's approaching the camera, and we're catching him in each stage, and he eventually ends up dying in front of the camera. So this will most likely be on the Digipack spread once you open the Digipack. Thanks.
This is what happened in 1993. We had a contact named William Cooper. He wrote a book called Behold the Pale Horse. William Cooper was retired naval intelligence for 38 years. Bill was second in command of the 7th Fleet. Bill had access to the documents about what our government, the United States government, is doing, not only in Area 51, but in Dulce and 24 other secret bases around the country. In 1993, I divested myself of any of this kind of involvement with UFOs or government intrigue. I wasn't interested anymore. I didn't want to have anything to do with anything. When I got a call in Las Vegas from two women I know, and they said, we have some information from Bill Cooper, who was touring the country at that time, doing seminars like this, trying to explain to the American people what our government was doing and how it all ties together. Since then, Bill's been murdered by two policemen here in Nevada 2 years ago. They say he was drunk and they had to shoot him and murder him in front of his wife and two children. This is serious stuff. Make no mistake about this, these people are very serious. Anyway, these two women, friends of mine from Alaska, had been in contact with Bill and said, we have some information that on a Wednesday evening at about 8:30 in the evening, the United States government was going to be test driving UFOs out of Area 51. I agreed to go with them against my better judgment. We went out to Area 51. This is before they pulled the perimeter back 60 miles. This is when you could actually get on the rim and look down into Area 51. We were in Area 51 on the border for about 25 minutes when Wackenhut, the security guards that protect the outer perimeter of Area 51, they're called Yellow Fruit, that's their technical name, pulled up in their jeeps with machine guns and asked us what we were doing there. And we said, well, on public land, and we're just stargazing. They asked for our identification, they ran us, they asked if they could search our car. We said, not a problem. We gave them our ID, let them search our cars. The two women I was with had the cameras placed on their persons. They didn't frisk the women. They asked us to leave. We said, we're on public land. We're just going to stay here and spend the night. The last thing they told us was this. There's a lot of unexploded ordnance out here. This is part of the Nevada testing range. We wouldn't want you getting hurt out here. After Wacken had left us, they drove approximately 35 to 40 yards away from us, and they parked their two jeeps on the side of the road, turned their lights on. We thought that was interesting. They were gonna stick around for a while. So were we. Out came the lawn chairs, and we just laid on our lawn chairs, looking at the sky. Now the information we'd been given through William Cooper, Bill had access to what was going on in Area 51. Bill told us it would be about 8:30, and these UFOs, whatever kind of craft they were, they were going to be doing maneuvers this particular evening. Okay. So we waited about another 15 minutes, and one of the women that I was with screamed, oh my God, and we turned, the other woman and myself, to look in the direction that she was looking. We're all looking at different parts of the sky. And as we turned, we saw 24 dish-shaped objects take the sky in a matter of a second. It was the most spectacular thing I'd ever seen. A beautiful, clear night. And then we start counting, 1, 2, 3, 4. We're trying to count, and there were 24 of them, and we were stunned. Now, while we were observing this, the two Wacken Head Jeeps were still there with their lights on. They were observing this also. For the next 35 minutes, we timed it and photographed it with still cameras, the two women I was with. For the next 35 minutes, these 24 disc-shaped silver objects, that changed color, by the way, did the most amazing maneuvers that I had ever seen anything in the sky do. Now, I don't know. That's why they're called UFOs, unidentified flying objects. Right angle, left angle turns, 2, 4. They just do these incredible maneuvers for 35 minutes, in tandem, singly. It was obviously some type of maneuvering exercise, and it staggered my imagination at the speed that they were moving. And this took part in the northwestern sky for approximately 35 minutes. They all came back together in formation, and then in one fell swoop, they just left and went back into Area 51, that direction, over the horizon, the mountain. Then we experienced something very unusual. The entire valley that we were standing on, we felt something, it's hard to describe, but if you've ever been in New York and felt the subway go underneath your feet, there was this energy level underneath the whole valley. Something moved underneath the entire valley underneath us, from north to south. And we literally heard and felt some energy level move underneath the valley. I interpreted that because there's always been stories that there's hundreds and hundreds of miles of caves and caverns and underground airport facilities in that area where they keep these flying craft. But we felt something move underneath us. Now, by this time, we were pretty excited. The girls were excited, and I was excited, because we had actually this on film. They were putting more film in their cameras, and we were waiting for something else to happen, and nothing happened for approximately 20 minutes. And then it started. This is the bad part. One of the women I went saw it before I did, and she screamed, "Oh my God." And as I looked in her direction at the sky, the only way I can describe it, it was about a half the size of a full moon, the largest full moon that I've ever seen. And it was just this silver Nova-shaped ball that appeared. Now, it was just a silver ball that appeared in the sky, but it was huge. I can't tell you the dimensions. All I could say, it appeared in the horizon to be a third the size of the largest moon that I've ever seen. And then out of it came another one. And then another one. There were three of them in the night sky. At this point, something very unusual happened. A very bad feeling came over the three of us. The two women I was with were photographing this, and they became hysterical. Myself, being as scared as I was, I start praying in tongues. I'm one of those tongue talker guys, you know, fire baptized, Holy Ghost man guy. That's how scared I was. And all I said was, "Thank you, Lord, for allowing me to see this. Now, please protect me and my friends. And thank you for letting me see this before whatever else comes." I was terrified. And it was just three huge silver orbs in the sky. And then they disappeared. But that bad feeling, that horrible sensation that there was something very wrong in the area was still with us. 30 seconds later, approximately, the other part of the sky, it formed again. And it's just this silver nova orb, perfectly round, huge. And this time out of it came five orbs. The women were still hysterical, but they were trying to put more film in the cameras and they were photographing this. It's hard to describe the terror that just those five orbs. They were there for several minutes and they disappeared. A few minutes later, on the other side of the valley, it started again. This time, seven orbs came out of the first one. This went on for approximately 35 minutes, I was timing it, and then it stopped, thank God. Because by this time, the women were crying, they were hysterical. I was very upset myself, and it stopped. Within 1 to 1.5 minutes, we heard something whistling. And we both looked again to the northwest, and a comet, a low-flying comet with a tail of about 300 feet long, was shooting across the valley, approximately 150 feet over our head, with this huge red orb on the front of it. There was a huge red orb on the front of it. It was a silver tail about 300 feet, whistling, and it came from the northwest, and it passed over our heads, about 150 feet over our heads, whistling, and passed us. That was it for us. We quit snapping pictures. Once it was gone, the two Wacken Hut Jeeps that were there turned their ignitions on, their lights went on, and they drove away. The women had calmed down, I had calmed down. We were trying to collect our thoughts. The next thing I remember, I woke up in the back seat of our car the next morning. One of the women that was with us was in the front seat waking up. The other woman that was with us was out on the lawn chair. We all woke up at the same time. I had no idea how I got in the back of the car. The gal that I was with in the front seat, she had no idea how she got there. The last thing the three of us remember is we were talking, sitting on our lawn chairs about what had happened. It's the last thing we remember. At that point, I said, let's just leave. Let's go home. Enough of this UFO area, but I've had enough. I'm not interested anymore. That's when we heard the helicopter. Again, approaching from the northwest. I saw it. I said, let's go before they get here. Yes, it was a huge black helicopter. No insignia. The women wanted to wait till it got there, against my better judgment. I said, okay. The helicopter drove along the rim of Area 51, pulled up right over on top of us. We could actually see the airman inside with his white helmet, his black shield, taking photographs of us. I said, ladies, is that enough? Can we go now? They said, let's get the hell out of here. We got in the car and we drove away. The black helicopter followed us for maybe 6 or 7 miles and then just left. When we returned to Las Vegas, very shook up, very scared. Some of William Cooper's friends had been notified that we were out there. We were met by one Anthony J. Hilder from Radio Free America and World Radio. He brought in Japanese television. We were interviewed. I gave the same interview to Japanese television. This aired in Japan, Korea, and Taiwan. It was also in the Newsweek edition of Tokyo newspapers. At that time, we were witnesses to the largest multiple sighting in Area 51. I just want to say this. I'm not interested in UFOs anymore. I'm not interested in what the government's doing out there, but I will say this. Whatever our government's doing out there, they finally admit that there is an Area 51. Yeah. They've denied it for years. Whatever's going on out there is not a good thing, in my opinion. What we experienced out there that night, if that can instill that type of fear into an individual like me, I can imagine what it would do if there was some type of incident like that over Southern California or Northern California. It panicked me. I don't know what it was. I don't know if they're extraterrestrials. I'm one of those kind of men that's not interested in things that don't concern me. I'm not interested in UFOs anymore. Just the fish guy, and I want to feed hungry people all over the world. And thank you for your time.
Thank you.